Okay, so I took down and took apart the rest of the pieces that I had to take apart, which was the cross slide, the compound, and the tailstock. I didn't tape any of that just because it's really, really straightforward. It's just basically unscrew the screws and slide them apart. And we didn't run into any hiccups there. Well, we did run into one hiccup on the compound. So what happens is, this is the gib, and it's a tapered gib, for the compound, okay? So it rides in one side of the dovetail, and then this screw rides in this slot, right? And it's supposed to have a piece that's here to basically trap that screw, and by turning that screw, you move the gib in and out. Well, I snapped that little tab off. I still have the piece. It's in a bag and, you know, in a safe spot. So all I need to do basically is just silver solder it back on. But the reason why it broke was because this screw here, as you can tell by the slot there, somebody went a 100-pound gorilla on it, and the screw itself and get the camera to pick it up. The screw itself is actually bent. Okay, so there's not that much clearance in this slot for the head. So as it wobbled back and forth, it just put enough pressure on it and snapped that little tab off. Unfortunately, there was no other way to get this out without having to drill this out and try to get the stud out. So, you know, I just went at it and hoped for the best, and we ended up cracking that, but again, easy fix. Now, as far as the cross slide goes, we had pretty much what I thought we were going to have, and we have a worn screw and nut, and I was planning on making new ones anyway. Now, that doesn't have to be done until we get the whole lathe back together again, but it's just something on the list. You can visibly see here's the nice new untouched thread, and here it is in the middle. So you can see that there's a different size difference from here to here. There's also some more narrow by pipe wrench there, and this is the housing that goes on the compound there, or cross slide rather, and we have a lot of slop in there. So my plan is we're going to end up remaking this, but we have this gear to contend with, and I don't have any provisions to cut gears. I don't have an indexer to be able to do this. So I'm going to do like I did on my 9-inch lathe, where what we'll do is we'll cut this end off here, we'll drill and ream, obviously this all being a 4-jaw so we can dial everything in, we'll cut this off here, we'll drill and ream into this gear, and we'll insert a new piece and either Loctite it in place or Loctite it and pin it, or just pin it, or somehow, you know, attach it to there. My 9-inch lathe, I had to do this when I did the large dial conversion, and that's just Loctite it in place, and it's been there for the past 5 years. This side, same thing. I'll cut it here, and we can drill and ream inside here and insert a new piece and thread it. Or I can actually probably order a piece of threaded rod here and just insert that Acme threaded rod. This housing, what we'll probably end up doing, since we only have a bearing spot here and here, and we have a relief in here, we can insert, can drill and ream straight through, get it all nice and straight, and add some bronze bushings there to take up the slack. Now, while I'm at it, what I'm probably going to do, this sits on there like this, dial sits on here like that, and then the handle sits here. So you have slot between this and this and this, all right? So that's giving you some play. And the way to take that up was you used to just, you know, push the dial in and tighten it down, and that used to jam everything together. Well, I'm going to do like I did on my 9, and what I'm going to do is I'll probably trim a little bit of this back here, and I'll add a ball thrust bearing here. And then in this side here, I'll dig away a little bit of this material, recess it, and put a nice thrust bearing in here that'll run along the dial there. So we can get that really, really tight without binding, because we're now on bearings instead of metal-to-metal contact. And we can eliminate this whole section here, this whole section here, as a source of backlash. Then all our backlash will be in our screw and nut, which will be new, so we can minimize it pretty good. So that's probably a modification there. And we have a similar issue with the compound screw here. You know, we're worn, but this is a relatively straightforward turning job. And say I can just remake this out of one piece, not a big thing. So, again, this stuff doesn't have to be done until we're actually ready to run the lathe and get everything else together, but it's going to be a project down the road. So, let me show you a couple issues that we have with the tailstock, and then I'll show you probably prepping some stuff for paint, and we'll go from there. Okay, so we took the tailstock apart here, pretty self-explanatory, just a nut on the back, and a cap, barrel, and then the clamping mechanism. Really not that much there. So we did find a couple of problems. So now if you look at the barrel here, if the camera will pick it up in the light, if I turn it this way a little bit. Alright, you see this black mark here? Alright, that's rubbing. That's from this actual casting rubbing. And what it was inside here, right in here, all right, is where the clamping mechanism goes. And let me try to hold it and get my finger in there. You can see where my finger is. Right on the top of this edge here, there was a ridge. There was a little bump out, like when it got clamped down by somebody that tightened it really, really tight, and it kind of pushed a little metal in. And this was really hard to get out. So I just went in there with my Dremel tool and the grinder and just relieved that edge right on the inside. So now, goes in there nice. It stops there because I haven't cleaned past that point. As far as rocking goes, it actually isn't that bad, surprisingly. It's about a 1/16 of an inch of movement side to side, which I can deal with. I'm not really concerned about that. The Morse taper in here does have some scarring. All right, I was pretty much expecting to see that on a school lathe. You know, a tool spun in here once or twice. Not a big thing that can be kind of taken out with a Morse taper reamer, or at least all the highs taken off. You shouldn't have an issue. The screw here, you can see they put a cap screw on the end, and that was to act as a pusher, probably for tangless tools. It probably wasn't kicking out tools that didn't have a tang. It's kind of a common fix, not a huge thing. What the big problem is, there's a lot of wear on this screw and this nut. Okay, so now we can fix that pretty easily. And a tailstock, unlike a lead screw or a feed screw on the cross slide, is going to be worn throughout because you're always backing this in and out to its full length of travel. So this really isn't that big of an issue to fix. All we need to do, really, let me unscrew this all the way again. We just need to replicate this piece, which really isn't that bad, and which I would want to do anyway, because we got, again, knurled by pipe wrench here, and here, and here, and our keyway is wallowed out. So this is a relatively simple piece to replicate. As far as this thread goes, this thread is only this big, about as big as this oil relief groove, okay? So what we can do is just set this up in the four-jaw chuck to run nice and true. We can come in here and bore this out and just get a standard Acme nut to fit this thread. And we can Loctite that sucker in place and use that as our thread. And then we don't have to buy an Acme tap. We can just put these out, put a nice little bushing in there, a nut, and then call it a day and call that a nice repair. So that's going to have to be remade. Okay, so we're set up here in the mill, and this is the compound here, and I dressed it with a file, but you can still see all these gouges in here and nicks from having the tool post pretty much in that one spot. So I want a fresh surface here. Now I'm not worried about, I know there's all kinds of chinguses in the front here from hitting the chuck,
Those can probably be rounded out with a belt sander, made to look a little bit better, so I'm not going to touch those in the mill. What I really want to do is just get a nice flat surface here and even on both sides. So I have everything on parallel, we're locked down. Now, we're not going to be taking off much material here, maybe 5,000. So it's a good chip right here, which I'm not worried about getting out. I just want, you know, to get rid of some of these little gouges here. So we're almost touching there. This is a roughing end mill, 3/4 inch, and we should be able to do fine in this cast iron. So I'm just going to go here and touch, and we'll take off 5,000ths and see what this cleans up, and then go from there. Helps if you put it in the right direction, right? Because I have it in back gear from the last time I used it. Get some speed on. See how that works out. So it's going to go to the touch. Alright, there's a touch. I'm going to set 0 on my dial. And we're going to take 5,000ths and see what happens here. Surface finish. I'm going to file this nice and smooth. I just want to get down to a level playing field, just about. Okay, so I don't know how much of that you saw. I gotta figure out a better position, camera position for this, but I got 90% of it off here. I'm gonna take another 5 and we'll call that a day. Okay. Okay, so those are nice and even. Just nip the top of those two little oil ports there too while we're at it. Clean those up. So those had some pitting in there. And we'll just dress this file smooth. All right, this is the base here. And I have it all stripped out. And hopefully it shows up on camera. But you can see some of this lighter gray areas. Like here, here, here. What all that is the filler that they used on this. Now, if I just painted over this is super rough. It'll look like crap. It'll look like you painted over flaking paint, and it'll be all rough and crags and, you know, valleys in there. So this is probably a really rough casting. You can actually see over here all the grinding marks on the side. And what they did is they covered it in basically a body filler. But whatever the hell they used is seriously some industrial stuff, because it won't even come off with an angle grinder. I'm not going to bother getting it off since it's adhered really well. I don't think there'll be an issue with it. But what I'm going to do is just fill in and smooth out all the stuff that did come off with just some good old Bondo. So that's pretty much the boring part. So there's no point in taping any of that. But basically we're just going to putty this up with some Bondo. We're going to sand it smooth and try to get as even a finish as we can. Now this isn't a Ferrari. We just want to fill in most of the big, you know, lumps and bumps, you know. All right, excuse the furnace there for a second. I'm actually on the other side of the shop, which is right next to the furnace, so. You can see I got the Bondo on there, and I didn't cover the whole surface. I'm not really worried about it. All I did was take out the really, really big chunks and really big divots and kind of tried to smooth them out. So this all needs to be sanded. It looks like crap now, which, you know, is relatively normal. And it all needs to be sanded out. I am not the best Bondo applier in the world. I actually suck at it, but, you know, it's on there. It's stuck to the cast. It ain't going anywhere, but we just need to smooth this all out. So to take most of this down real easy, I'm just gonna use my little orbital sander. And it's actually hooked up to my shop vac. And I have one of those bag inserts in the shop vac. So this is just a little adapter. It comes in like a little tree, bunch of different sizes. Actually, it's one size bigger than this. I had to cut it off to be able to fit on the outlet of my sander. And it'll suck through those holes at the bottom and keep most of the dust down. Even still, I mean, no matter what, you're gonna get dust. And so I do have my little respirator just in case. You don't want to be breathing any of this stuff in. Just, you know, it ain't going to hurt you in the short run, but in the long term, crap like this kind of gets to you. So if you got one, use it. If not, even one of those little painter's masks, like little surgical deals, those will help you out too. You just don't want to be breathing that dust. Same thing when sanding the cast iron. You don't want to be breathing that. So off camera, I'm going to go start off with this and progressively work our way down and then to hand sand and get this as smooth as I can. Okay, so now they got tingly fingers from the vibration of the sander. I got this all sanded down to 120 grit. There's still some marks in it and still some rough spots here and there, but overall most of the big stuff is smoothed out. There's a little bit on the bend over here, and just a few spots. Now this is where you can really start chasing your tail. You can get down to the nitty-gritty with this stuff and really go all out with Bondo in every little nook and cranny and everything. But I just wanted to get most of the big chunks out of this and smooth out the original filler that was in there. So we accomplished that pretty much. Like I said, there are a few dings here and there. A lot of that will be taken up by paint. Whatever isn't, you know, it's a machine tool. It's going to get chipped and it's going to get oil on it. And eventually this paint's going to, you know, get as just as worn as the original paint. Well, actually, hopefully I live that long. But so you know, I've taken this to where I want to take it, or as far as I want to take it. What I want to do now is just get a tack cloth, and I want to wipe this all down. The vacuum, honestly, caught probably 95% of the dust. Caught all the fine particles, so there's no dust in the air. The only thing that I didn't catch was really, really heavy particles, which just fell to the floor. I was able to vacuum up afterwards. So hooking that sucker up to the vacuum cleaner works really good. And the good part about using the replaceable bags is that I didn't clog the filter or anything in there. Worked out real well. So let me get a tack cloth, wipe all this down, get all the dust off of it, and we'll get ready to paint it, and I'll show you what I'm going to use to paint this block. Okay, so we're starting to paint this, and I just want to mention one thing. What we're using to paint this with here is one of these 4-inch foam rollers, and they work great, and a brush to get into all the corners. Now, just one quick tip is they give you this little tray, but the tray doesn't have liners, so an easy way to make for quick cleanup is just to wrap the sucker in tin foil, and then once you're done, just throw the tin foil away. Also, if you're going to be doing multiple coats or multiple days of painting, and this goes for any roller, just take some like plastic wrap, cling wrap for like food, or a plastic bag, and cover the roller with it. That'll keep it from drying out, and that'll allow you to use it multiple times. So what we're doing is just loading up our little roller here, and just going right at it. Now, it might take a couple of coats here, but we'll get it all nice and painted up. So we'll come back when we're done with all this.